Welcome to Green and Red, scrappy politics for scrappy people, a regular podcast on radical environmental and anti-capitalist politics, brought to you by Bob Bazanko and Scott Parker.
Welcome to the silky smooth sounds of the Green and Red podcast. I am your co-host, Scott Parkin, today broadcasting from the Sierras. I'm near Truckee, California, and very excited about today's show and guest, longtime friend we're going to be talking to. As always, I am joined by...
Bob Bazanko. I'm in Houston. And as always, we open by thanking all of our listeners and viewers and ask you to continue to watch and listen and share these podcasts, whether they be on Apple or Spotify or on YouTube. Please rate and review them and subscribe and follow and like and all that, so our algorithms continue to grow and we can hit that million mark. And you know, we're coming after big lefty podcast, big lefty celebrity podcast. So, and when we owe it all to you and continue. Well, Scott's going to give a pitch for donors, but I want to thank, on my end, I want to thank the people who have donated. We have a couple newbies, which is awesome, joining our M19 Brigade. And so I've kind of stole Scott's line there. But thank you very much for sharing and spreading the word and hope we continue to do so. We do these shows and talk to people you will not hear elsewhere. We've just done amazing shows on the environment with Helen Yost and Diane Wilson. And so please continue to support us so we can do that.
Yep. And as I always want to ask people that besides sharing and following us on our social media channels, that if you have a couple extra bucks a month to become a donor to the Green and Red podcast, like Bob said, our M19 Brigade has actually grown in the last week. We have two new patrons. And if you want to become a patron, you can go to patreon.com/greenredpodcast and become a recurring donor. It could be just $2 a month. It could be just $1 a month. But, you know, every little bit helps us keep this going. And if you want to just make a one-time donation, you can go to greenredpodcast.org and hit the support button. That's also a real useful thing that you can do. And so for today's episode, we're going to be talking about India. And we're going to be talking with our longtime friend and comrade, Harbeer Sandhu, who is a award-winning writer, editor, and storyteller. He writes for a number of local public. He's written for a number of publications, many local to Houston. And then he's just returned from a trip to India, where he's been working on stories about the farmers' uprisings against the Modi government. And so, with great fanfare, we want to welcome our friend Harbeer Sandhu to the Green and Red podcast. Welcome to Green and Red, Harbeer.
Thank you. I've been listening to you guys for a long time, and it's nice to be on, and thank you for having me on to talk about this issue that's very personal to me to some extent.
And just to put it into a little bit of context, India has very much been in the news the last couple of weeks with this surge of COVID cases. We've seen... Last I was able to check, over 18 million new cases have been reported. Over like a 3-day period, there was a spike of a million new cases. So the death toll could peak at more than like 13,000 a day, with like according to current predictions. And so that's also led to a lot of like socio-political implications. Like the US and Australia, for example, have restricted travel to and from India. I actually saw where Australia has told Australian citizens in India that they can't come home. So clearly the global North is responding as how you would expect the global North. But then, you know, there's been promises of aid and vaccinations being sent to India from all over the world, particularly the US. Domestically, inside of India, I think it was just this weekend where we saw elections in West Bengal go pretty poorly for the ruling party, for Prime Minister Modi's BJP party in recent elections. And so just to kind of get to my question is, you know, you just recently returned from India. Can you tell us, you know, tell us a little bit about where you were, what you were seeing, what you were doing, et cetera?
So I was, for the most part, 95% of the 4 weeks that I was there, I was in the state of Punjab, where there are not elections underway at present. And so Punjab was under a pretty strict lockdown, as were like all the other states where there wasn't active campaigning. And, you know, that's actually led to or contributed large part to this current surge, because people see hypocrisy, just straight up hypocrisy from the ruling party, where they are allowing mass gatherings and campaign stops, where Modi has appeared and, you know, announced from the stage how elated he is to see like a sea of people standing shoulder to shoulder, you know, as far as the horizon. It kind of contributes to some of the skepticism and doubt about the severity of the pandemic, because of this, this inconsistent policy towards lockdowns and imposed, curfews and social distancing. They're saying one thing where the elections are not being held, and then, acting completely differently, actively campaigning in these other states where, they've got some skin to lose.
Yeah. It was just not that long ago, Modi was boasting to the world how India had kind of defeated COVID, and now this surge has hit. Now, as and everywhere else, but it seems like it's even more pronounced there. There's clearly a class distinction too, isn't there? As to who's getting hit hardest, who has access to medical attention, who has access to vaccines?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's the same the world over. People of, higher social classes have the ability to work from home or take time off. Labor is pretty cheap. And so, they have servants who can run any errands for them out in the market and whatnot, while they just sit at home and wait it out themselves. And the poor who are living hand to mouth and are not getting any aid, they have to go out to work to earn their daily bread. And as we're seeing in the US even, those deemed essential workers of necessity are being exposed, and those of means are able to sit at home and blow it off and act like nothing is going on. It's just business per usual.
So where you were traveling in Punjab, and it was under lockdown, were the streets quiet? Were they crowded? Were things shut down? How deep was the lockdown?
It's not as brutal as it was last spring, where police were like beating people and, making them stay home, where they may not even have provisions to last them for whatever duration. It was an open-ended lockdown. So, it could have lasted a couple of days. It could have lasted a few weeks. Like, they just didn't know. It was really not thought out at all. People were stranded thousands of miles away from home where they had gone to work as migrant labor. And, you know, there were no no transportation set up for people to get home. You know, we heard stories about like a young girl who purchased a bicycle and put her elderly father on the back and like biked like 1,000 kilometers home. You know, they just basically said like, you're not allowed to, you know, the trains are shut down, the buses are shut down, you're on your own. And, you know, that has had some tragic consequences as a result.
And there's a shortage of hospital beds, of oxygen, and I guess the vaccination program is kind of lagging. So right. Is it safe to say we're going to, you know, the worst is yet to come?
I hope not, but, you know, it appears so. As you know, the case numbers, hospitalization lags behind case numbers, and then deaths lag behind that. So, you know, as we're seeing like case numbers rise still, although I think there was maybe a slight dip in the last couple of days, hopefully that'll continue that trend. But yeah, I mean, even for non-COVID related, you know, things that people may need to go to the hospital for, you know, there's just no beds available. People are, you know, dying in their cars, dying on the streets, just waiting to get in. It's really tragic, and you know, it could have been prevented. And you know, as in other countries, we're seeing like the results of an authoritarian regime that's, you know, in not denial in a lot of ways. So, you know, yeah, we're seeing where authoritarianism can lead yet again.
Right. This is like not just accidental or, you know, they botched that. It's you know, going according to, I mean, Aaron Dottie Roy wrote a very powerful piece in The Guardian calling it a crime against humanity. And I think you could say the same probably, obviously, about like Brazil and the United States, too.
You know, and you've been, even before this surge happened, you've been documenting and telling stories about the farmers uprising against the Modi government, against the neoliberal policies. And we're going to talk about that. But before we get into that, I'm kind of curious. I'm assuming that part of your trip was to kind of further that documentation and storytelling. But, you know, what were the farmers and activists that you were talking to, what were they saying about this kind of recent COVID, this spike in COVID, this, you know, humanitarian crime?
They've got a kind of overconfidence, I would say. You know, these are people who are exposed to, you know, a lot of the filth on a daily basis. They've got pretty strong immune systems if they're still alive at this point. And so, I mean, they do come from a pretty hardy stock. I spoke to a filmmaker who comes from the you know, I'm gonna use some terms in the course of this conversation that I'm not comfortable with, but they are a reality, and people do deal with this, and there's really just no way around it. But this man is, you know, of a lower caste origin, and you know, from a landless farm worker background himself. He's made a great documentary called Landless, which is available for free on the internet. And I can give you guys a link to that later on if you're interested.
We can include it in the show notes.
And awesome. So he told me that two members of his crew fell ill. They had a pretty high fever. They insisted on continuing to work. These two young women, independent of one another, became ill. One is from Canada Another is from a city in the south of India near Bombay called Pune. He referred to them as being like of a privileged background. And he and his crew, you know, spent days in a car with these two women at different points. They had a high fever. They insisted on continuing to work. Like I said, they spent time in the car with other members of the crew who don't come from such privileged backgrounds. And according to him, he had a fever for a couple days, felt a little sluggish, and rebounded pretty quickly from that, as did the rest of his crew. Whereas these people who are coming from more privileged backgrounds like felt slightly more ill, but also recovered. So, COVID is slowly making its rounds like through the protest encampments also, of which there are five. But people are, for the large part, outdoors or in big tents that are open to the air, and they're eating communal meals together, and they've survived a lot worse, and so it seems like they're being spared like the worst of it, even if they're catching it.
Did you have another COVID question, Scott? Why don't you, because we've been talking to you for a while about coming on to talk about the farmers' protests, which were just massive and maybe the biggest ever, right, in one day. And you've written about this. You've been writing about this for a few months now. So do you want to kind of start by just giving us the background to that? Because the U.S. media didn't cover it all that extensively. And it was also occurring at a time when there's a lot of shit going on down here.
Yeah, I mean, the world is on fire.
So. Yeah, it's kind of hard, when you have people storming the Capitol to discuss war politics. But most of what I've learned, frankly, has come from you. I mean, pretty much everything I've learned has come from what you've written about it. So
yeah, you're the
expert.
Well, I'll do my best. I'm still learning myself. I hope I don't make any flat out incorrect statements, but, feel free to fact check me. Where to start? There has been an ongoing crisis in the farming regions of India, which has really become apparent in the last 20 years. With going back to the 1960s, the U.S. kind of used Mexico and India as a laboratory to test out innovative farming techniques. It was called the Green Revolution, spearheaded in large part by a man named Norman Borlaug from Texas A&M. And it basically introduced high yield wheat and rice, which for a time, beginning in the 1960s and like on through the 1980s, really increased the production of the fields in the north of India, where Punjab, which is where my family is from, Banj means five, Ab means rivers. It's the land of five rivers. These all come down from the Himalayas, and there's great big floodplain. It's very fertile. Going back to ancient times, the Indus River Valley civilizations. And for a time, there was great prosperity, and it became the breadbasket of India, one of the largest countries in the world. But these crops require a lot of fertilizers and pesticides and water. And so, you know, for the first time, they started tapping into the groundwater, whereas previously the fields had been irrigated by canals coming off the rivers. And, you know, it's great in the short term, but in the long term, the soil was being depleted and, you know, turning alkaline, and the water table is dropping. And it's, you know, very quickly, like, you know, within a generation, like turning the desert pretty much, the water table has dropped significantly. And then up in the mountains, you have deforestation, which also, you know, as Arundhati Roy has written and Vandana Shiva has written, you know, those soils in the forest like store water also and release it slowly. And, you know, those mountainsides are being eroded and glaciers are retreating. And, you know, water is a huge issue. It led to some great conflict in the 1980s that went through to the 90s. And, you know, as a result, some would say by government policy, there was a big increase in drug use among the youth who were traumatized by the campaign, you know, the quote unquote anti-terror campaigns, farmers who were being labeled, you know, farmers who were fighting for access to water and power, which was being generated by their own rivers being dammed up, you know, that electricity was being sent to other states and to big cities like Delhi. And the water was being redirected to other areas, you know, to irrigate the deserts of Rajasthan to, you know, to allow for agriculture there. And so this is, in some ways, you could say like the second round of that and second sort of uprising in response to that. And the government has tried once again to discredit the movement by calling it a you know, separatist terrorist campaign. And there's fear that, you know, it could go that route again. The Indian government plays pretty dirty sometimes, you know, with extrajudicial killings and smear campaigns, like, you know, on par with, if not like, even more brutal and authoritarian than, you know, the COINTELPRO that we saw in the 1960s and 70s in the US. And I can speak to these three laws that are being protested right now, so we can get that out of the way.
Are these more recent laws?
These laws.
Do you also, no, what I was going to say, do you also want to just kind of tell a little bit about Narendra Modi and the BJP, which has been in power since what, 2014, I believe?
2014.
Or would that be better to do later? It's up to you.
I can talk really quickly about that. I don't know all the details about, you know, the election and the rise to power. I know there were elections in 2014, 2017, and 2019 in which the BJP gained seats in all three of those. So last September, you know, in the midst of COVID, BJP, which has a pretty large majority in the lower house of parliament, passed three laws. You know, they passed easily in the lower house, and the upper house is more divided. Their majority is much slimmer. If I'm if I'm not mistaken, like it may actually be a coalition with other parties even. And so these laws, which to be frank, have been supported by the Indian Congress Party also in the past when they were in power, you know, now they're in the opposition and they're they've switched sides. But you know, one great thing about this protest is that it has eschewed all the traditional parties, you know, party members and even elected officials, you know, are welcome to come as individuals. They're encouraged to, but they're not given any time to speak from the stage, like as party representatives. And I think that's been a strength of this. Really quickly, the three laws, I'm gonna read from notes right now. There's the Farmers Produce Trade and Commerce Act, which expands the scope of trade areas of farmers' produce from select areas to any place of production, collection, and aggregation. This is sort of already in place. So it prohibits state governments from levying any market fees or levies on farmers. On any electronic trading farmers for platforms for a trade of farmers' produce conducted in outside trade area. So it's just a liberalization there of you know, what can be grown where, which, you know, really wasn't even there. Then there's the farmers, the doublespeak here is somewhat entertaining. The Farmers Empowerment and Protection Agreement on Price Assurance and Farm Services Act says it creates a framework for contract farming through an agreement between a farmer and a buyer before the production or rearing of any farm produce. It provides for a three-level dispute settlement mechanism. This law takes any contract disputes, like a farmer, you know, may enter into an agreement with giant agribusiness to grow a particular crop. And these contracts typically, the result of them is that the farmers will become like employees basically of PepsiCo or, you know, in India, the big large multinationals there are Reliance and the Geo Group and Tata and some of the other, you know, ConAgra is there, Monsanto is there. And under these contracts, the companies will stipulate all the inputs, you know, all the seed, the fertilizers, the pesticides. And so the farmers will be required to purchase all that like through whoever they've contracted with. And they set the prices, you know, they have like, you know, if a farmer like has a place where they can get those same products for cheaper, they're not allowed to use those. It takes the dispute settlement away from civil courts and places it into the hands of a arbitration, which is appointed by the central government. So it's taking power away from the courts, which, you know, of the three branches of the Indian government, like up to this point, have been like one of the few relatively independent review bodies and putting that dispute resolution like into the hands of political appointees from the central government. So, you know, just centralizing more of that power. And then there's the Essential Commodities Act, which a lot of the staple foods are regulated, you know, going back to ancient times and the rise of agriculture, like anybody with the capacity to store essential food products has all the power to set the prices. You know, they can sit on the grain. You know, it's not going to rot for as long as they want to. And, you know, people need it to survive. And so they can set the prices, they can, you know, they control the supply. And, you know, in ancient Mesopotamia, it was the priests that had control of the granaries and, you know, people who were living hand to mouth are sort of at their mercy. And so, you know, what the government has up till this point purchased a certain amount of these foodstuffs and stored them, distributed them through like welfare schemes. You know, this would kind of put an end to that and leave consumers at the mercy of the marketplace, which is very easily manipulated by those who have the capacity to store and manipulate the market.
Before I ask a question, I just want to remind folks that you're listening to Harbeer Sandhu, writer and journalist. We're talking about the current crisis in India, both around COVID and around the mass protests that we've been seeing. And so, you know, Harbeer, you just talked about these three laws which the government has passed in recent years, and these are essentially the basis of what has like led to the protest, to the mass protests that we saw this year in January.
So these laws were passed in September, all three of them.
Oh, sorry. For some reason, I thought it was 2019. And so that's what led to like a mass mobilization of people on the streets. I think in January, we saw a huge mass blockade of the city of New Delhi, the capital, with millions of farmers with tractors and things like that. I'm wondering if you could talk about that reaction a little bit.
Okay, so
how did these laws affect farmers in their daily lives?
Well, as of now, they have not, there's been a stay declared by the Supreme Court. So they are not being enforced at this point. But I want to go back to the passage of these laws a little bit. Like I said, they easily passed the lower house of parliament, where the BJP has a large majority. And, you know, some attribute that to like straight up election interference using electronic voting machines. But whatever the case may be, like they do have a large majority in the lower house, and it handily passed. In the upper house, like I said, I believe they're in a coalition. And so, there was opposition, vocal opposition, but under COVID, COVID restrictions, they were kind of rammed through a voice vote. You know, had the actual votes been counted, there's a good chance that they would not have passed. But, you know, it was ram through just, you know, with the, you know, the eyes have it gavel, you know, done. So that was, I believe the date was September 25th, sometime in late September. And in response to that, the farmers in Punjab were the most organized at that point. And they saw that, you know, this in the long term would end up being a large land grab by these giant agribusiness multinational corporations. And so they rose up at that point in Punjab. They blockaded the trains and there was a lot of localized protests, and as their numbers grew, they sort of backed down at that point and shifted their focus to a new campaign called Delhi Chalo, let's go to Delhi, where you know, the seat of government is. And so they, you know, made all their preparations and organized and loaded up their tractors and trailers with months worth of provisions, and decided to, you know, descend on New Delhi. So Delhi is like DC, union territory. It doesn't belong to any one state. It's, you know, belongs to the whole country being the capital. And they, you know, started heading down from different places, largely from the north of India. Delhi is in the north. You know, you can't really drive a tractor from the far reaches of the country. It's about 200 miles from where my family lives, which is close to the Pakistan border. And they were met there with, you know, brutal riot police. This was early winter. You know, people had water cannons turned on them. They were beaten with wooden, you know, batons. And I mean, we're talking about elders, you know. And so they got as far as basically the border of New Delhi, and couldn't really go any further. The government had dug like 10-foot wide trenches in these brand new toll roads, the highways. And so, you know, they just set up their tents there while we were celebrating Thanksgiving here stateside, November 25th, 26th. And at the same time, there was a workers' general strike India-wide. I think that's what you might be referring to. There was a strike of 250 million people, which, you know, baffles the mind. We haven't heard really anything about in the States. That's like almost the whole population of the United States participated in this one-day general strike. And
only in lefty social media did you hear about it.
and yeah, since then, you know, they were there like all through the winter. They were camped out in I'll say freezing cold. You know, it wasn't actually like 32 degrees, 0 degrees Celsius, but, you know, I mean, when you're exposed to the elements, you know, they don't have REI there, you know, they don't have all the gear that we have. Yeah, so they were there all through the winter. Like I said,
is there a specific like demand or specific program, or is it kind of a more broadly kind of anti BJP, anti Modi,
The demands, the one demand is just the repeal of these three laws.
Okay.
And the farmers do recognize that there are like other issues in agriculture. You know, we've seen like a rash of suicides rising every year for the last 20 years, 20 plus years. So there's a problem with debt. There's these other like environmental issues, like I mentioned, like and this is one thing that, you know, I don't fully comprehend. Like, it seems to me like in some ways they're fighting to maintain an unsustainable status quo. In my mind, you know, they're saying like, let's repeal these three laws and then we'll see about those other things afterwards. But, you know, you have all these people mobilized at this moment, like it's would be really difficult to replicate, like if they were to go home. You know, I'm of the opinion, like if you've got other demands, like, you know, put them on the table now. But it is a very, very broad and diverse coalition, you know, from like sort of mainstream liberal to radical left. And so these, you know, that's one thing that everybody can agree on. So unequivocally, you know, like these three laws must be repealed. So,
you know, talking about the Indian radical left, it's nice to note that you have your Indian communist flag there behind you.
Yeah, we'll talk a little bit about that afterwards too.
Kerala is probably the first thing I ever learned about Indian politics. And up until, you know, kind of not that long ago, it had done a pretty great job actually dealing with COVID. Are they still kind of on top of things there, or is it kind of just overwhelmed?
I can't speak to that.
Because, you know, I've seen, like, again, in the lefty press, you know, this kind of Kerala's like was the success story for a long time. The first several people I ever met from India were from Kerala, so I just figured everybody in India was a communist. I thought of that when Scott mentioned it.
You know, talking about the sort of unsustainable maintaining of the status quo, this is kind of borders a little bit more of the world in which I do like work in, which is around environmental organizing and climate organizing, is that I part of Modi's program, but I believe it actually predates the Modi government, has been this like vast expansion of the construction of coal plants around India to kind of power this unsustainable maintenance of the status quo. And one thing that's also not reported in Western press, other than lefty social media and lefty media, is that there's actually local protest movements against every coal plant that's under construction because of the environmental health, mostly because of the environmental health impacts. And I've seen video for over a decade now of just like riot police fighting, you know, local communities, local villages, local towns over that. And it's just, it seems like this is just more of that, like just other sectors, farming, workers, et cetera.
Yeah, and it baffles the mind, you know. These laws are you know, liberalization of the agricultural sector towards, you know, more corporate control, and, you know, which inevitably is gonna to lead to more processed foods and things like that, which, you know, we in the West like seem to be moving away from. You know, we've got like the rise of like all these farm to table restaurants, and, you know, your like heirloom crops and more local seasonal production in the West. And it seems like India under Modi is you know, taking that country towards the direction of like more processed like junk food. What was I gonna say? You know, we saw this policy like fail at the global scale, like with the falling apart of the Doha round of the WTO negotiations in 2006, where it was, you know, trying to put an end to subsidies in agriculture and in the global agricultural trade, where, you know, we finally saw developing countries stand up and say, like, you know, you want us to lift all these barriers to trade. You know, countries like the United States are providing something somewhere along the lines of 70% subsidies to North American farmers. And, you know, we saw, you know, I don't know if you recall, but 2003 Cancun WTO ministerial, where the South Korean farmers were protesting the, you know, kind of imposed importation of rice from rich countries, you know, at a scale where the local farmers just could not compete. Like, you know, you've got like taxpayer subsidized rice from the United States, like being sold way below the market rate in South Korea. And, you know, famously, there was the farmer who like climbed the fence and committed suicide at the Cancun WTO. You know, and it seemed like that whole idea had just, you know, been shelved and put away. And now, you know, 15 years later, we're seeing like India impose with an iron fist these these policies that are being rejected, and roundly rejected, like in 2006 in Doha.
You can never really doubt that the neoliberals won't put something in the file and then pull it out of the file 15 years later to try and get it to happen again.
And yeah, you know, my last meal, my last like fancy meal before all the lockdowns and COVID last year was at a farm to table kind of restaurant where, you know, had tiny portions, of course. Yeah. It cost, you know, what someone earns in a month in India, you know, and it came with a story on the menu of, you know, it was actually a African-American chef and related, you know, a lot of his menu to what had been like the fare of, you know, either sharecroppers or even like slaves. And you know, India's like celebrating the arrival of like Kentucky Fried Chicken and Subway. Like,
were people pretty willing to talk to you? I'm pretty open. Mm-hmm. And that actually was kind of part of another question. Moody obviously is trying to suppress information about, especially now, about COVID. And is there kind of a general repression? I mean, we, you know, he comes to power with this, you know, ultra Hindu nationalism going after Muslims. And, you know, he has this big following in the United States with people like Tulsi Gabbard. The president of the University of Houston is a big fan of his, Renu Kator, and other, you know, Hindus, and they're attacking Muslims. He's invaded Kashmir. Is all that part of a public debate, a public dialogue?
You know, there were, and this is, you know, one reason to support this movement is, There were really repressive laws like being passed last year, like through the summer and spring of 2020 into the fall, even where Muslim people were being denied citizenship. Like they, you know, were there was a law that was passed that you, you know, have to prove that your father and your grandfather had been born in India in order to. Muslims have been in India for over 1,000 years, you know, and people don't have like records, they don't have birth certificates and things like that, you know, like, and so, you know, in a way it seemed like they were trying to continue like the exodus that followed independence in 1947 when Pakistan and, you know, what has since become Bangladesh were divided from the country of India. There was another law they were calling the Love Jihad, where it was prohibiting marriage and relationships between Muslims and non-Muslims, just really heartless, like cruel policy. But since the farmers' protest has begun, it has deflected like all that attention and distracted the Modi government, and people are grateful to that for that. You know, there's a lot of caste-based issues. And this movement is uniting people from like many different communities, and also deflecting attention away from some of these other repressive policies. Like, you know, India calls itself the world's largest democracy, but you know, as we know, democracy like is not just majority rule, it's majority rule with minority protections. And India really falls short on the minority protections. And you know, as you were saying, like there's an ongoing crackdown on journalism, on independent voices, you know, even Twitter and Facebook employees have been threatened. Amnesty International was kicked out of the country in in September of 2020. So, you know, it sort of begs the question, like, you know, what have you got to hide? Like, if you're keeping out the human rights monitors and not allowing for any independent voices, you know, and then Modi's followers, you know, like they just cannot handle any kind of criticism. You know, there was one day a couple months ago when both Rihanna, the pop star, and Greta Thunberg, the, you know, climate activist, tweeted just one tweet each in support of the farmers movement. And man, they caught the wrath of like all these keyboard warriors. You know, like, how dare you criticize India, like, you sitting there in the West, what do you know, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, much worse, like, the most vile, disgusting things, you know, I say about them. And Greta Thunberg, like, we're talking about a child, you know, like, it's really, really disgusting. They can't handle any kind of criticism.
Trump went after her, so... They have a lot in common. I think, there's actually a legit question. Modi and Trump are very similar, but I get the sense Modi is actually a little smarter and more efficient than Trump, and therefore probably more dangerous. Is that?
I don't know how much smarter he is.
Oh, okay, well, that might be a blessing. I don't know. I mean,
he might be a little better spoken than Trump. Yeah.
I mean, I get that. It looks like there's a similar implosion occurring right now if these election results, because it wasn't just in Bengal. I think there were other places, too, where the BJP is starting to kind of take a hit. So hopefully this is, you know, kind of growing throughout.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what it'll take. I don't know how he's still winning votes.
Yeah,
he has lost some support, though.
Trump got 74 million after killing, 200,000 by COVID on election day. So who knows? Before we go, because I think we're getting close to the end on it, but I one of the things we like to do here is we're alternative media, and we like to shout out other alternative media. So I want to kind of give a shout out to Unicorn Riot. I gave them some money last year, and they sent me this shirt about a week or so ago. They did some awesome online streaming last year from Minneapolis and Seattle and Portland and elsewhere. So please support them, because like Green and Red Podcast, they're showing you things and telling you things that you're probably not going to hear elsewhere. Certainly not from a particular group of people in Brooklyn who won't, who I won't mention, but you know, they rhyme with Capo Crap House.
And I really hope that, and this is something that I want to work on personally, is reaching out with the spirit of internationalism and, you know, asking how we can support the struggles of farmers in other places and turn this into a global conversation.
You know, and that's been a big theme on our show, is trying to kind of elevate the spirit of internationalism, particularly to left circles in the US who definitely see it, you know, don't prioritize it. We often see like these left figures, you know, the radical socialists of Bernie Sanders or AOC, but then their, you know, their foreign policy views suck. And so we spend a lot of time on this show lifting up the internationalist pieces here, which is one of the reasons that we were excited to feature this episode with you about your recent trip to India, and also just the recent what's happening there and the kind of current crisis.
Thank you for, oh, I'm sorry, go ahead. I want to thank Herb. It's been great to talk to somebody who was there. We have this first person account. So I really appreciate it. I've learned more from you about this, like I said, than from anywhere else. So
yep.
And thanks for your interest, and thanks for having me on.
And folks, you've been listening to her writer and longtime friend of the Green and Red Podcast. We go back nearly 20 years, I would say at this point. I hate to admit that we're all that old. You will learn a whole lot more about this episode through our social media channels. If you want to check us out on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, this episode, and probably actually a few short clips of it, will be on our YouTube channel. So just go to our, you know, search Green and Red Podcast on YouTube and hit subscribe. And then if you want to become a recurring donor, go to our Patreon page at patreon.com/greenandredpodcast, or you can go and make a one-time donation at greenandredpodcast.org to hit the support button. But it's been great talking with you today, Harbeer.
You can call me Herb Scott.
Yeah. We're just trying to keep like the professional broadcasting thing. Our friend Harbeer he goes by Herb, and that's what we call him. It's been hard to call him Harbeer today.
Yeah, I
want to
show off one of my other signs.
Yep. Police uniform equals gang colors for folks listening on the audio.
The Ku Klux Klan, right?
Yeah. So, folks, stay safe out there. Get involved. Get angry. And do something productive with the anger. And we'll talk to you again real soon.
And then maybe, you know, try to find a little love and then get motivated by that too.
Yeah, exactly. All right.